1977. I first came to Nashville on a whirlwind tour of the Eastern United States in 1957. And I was honored to have a very nice look at Cumberland Caverns with Roy Davis in those days. And Ed Yarbrough. Is Ed here tonight?
Right here.
Hey.
Right.
Good to see you, more
or less.
And when I got here in 1985, Chicago not only had weekend trips, but I was delighted to find that they had Wednesday night trips. I really enjoyed going with the Grotto to Vaughn's Gap Cave, Parachute Cave. They weren't very big caves, as you all know. But in those caves, I found signatures, historic signatures. Roy Davis, 1951. Nashville Grotto has its ups and downs, as we all have. But over the years, it's been one of the outstanding grottos of the NSS. As I said, I'm very pleased to have had a small part in it in the last 30-some years. I was not a charter member of the NSS, although some people have written me up as such. I joined in 1947, as I said. I had had trouble finding the NSS. I had been caving in Virginia. I was a counselor at Camp Wallowatula for boys at Melboro Springs. The camp electrician was a Mr. Clark, whose family had owned Clark's Cave since the 1700s. And he invited a bunch of us over, and I was hooked. But he didn't know how to contact the NSS. They had contacted him in the past. And I had to wait until an article appeared in the Safeway Stores magazine, Family Circle. Then I gave the NSS address, 510 Star Building, Washington, D.C. I immediately got in touch with them and found a fascinating group of cave explorers, cave scientists from the U.S. museums downtown in Washington, D.C. This all began with a Sunday school outing club, a Unitarian Church in Washington, D.C. They went to visit one of the local caves, and several of their members were fascinated. They formed what they called the Speleological Society of the District of Columbia, and that appeared on the cover of what is recognized now as the first issue of the NSS Bulletin. Bulletin number one, if you'll fish this out for me.
Yeah.
You can pass that around. This is a reprint. I've got an original, but it's not in the world's best condition. I don't think it would have taken the handling. But a year had passed, they realized they were onto a very important idea and started thinking nationally from the very beginning. And the second issue of the NSS Bulletin, clear back in 1941, carried the name National Speleological Society.
$0.50 per copy.
Yeah. And one thing led to another. Bill Stevenson was the real founder, although he had NSS member number three. His wife Merle was NSS member number one.
Who was number two?
Number two was somebody else who wanted to disband the NSS during the war. Nobody remembers his name anymore. I first came to Nashville in 1957 in the middle of a thunderstorm. The water was running down the gutters and onto the sidewalks. And I never dreamed that I would be coming here for 37 years. But my daughter wanted to be an engineer, and not many schools were taking girls in engineering courses in the 1970s, I guess it was. So I started having ties then that led to where I am now. My home is Seattle. My family moved from Atlanta to Seattle in November 1927. So I don't remember very much about the South at that time, but I did maintain ties with the South because my mother was from South Carolina. Bill Stevenson had his faults, like we all do, but he had a vision, and he carried through with it to see the National Society. And when he found out that I was going back west when I finished medical school, he specifically gave me the assignment of spreading the gospel of the NSS in the West. In 1948, there was a grotto in Indiana, and several grottos in the Virginias and New England and so on, but there was none west of Indiana. So I interned in Pasadena and called for people to come together and form a Southern California grotto, and they did. Some really distinguished people were at that first meeting, including Denny Constantine, the great bat expert. After 2 years there, I moved on to Seattle, which was home for a year, and set up the Cascade Grotto. It had more than its share of difficulties, and for a time went obsolete. Those days, there were no roads into the mountains where the caves were, and they were just starting to find lava tube caves when the group lost its enthusiasm and had to be restarted. Actually, it was by a non-NSS caver who found the caves on Cave Ridge, 60 miles east of Seattle, in an isolated block of marble. And they're still pushing them deeper after something like 80 years. They're down to maybe 800 feet up there. Then I moved on to Denver. And George Moore had just come to Denver. And John Thrailkill, an early Colorado caver, came into the NSS. And he became a professor of geology. So this Colorado grotto was off to a great start. And I moved on to Salt Lake City, which is a major part of my life, over the next 5 years. The Wasatch Range had limestone caves in it, including Death Canyon Cave, which was the deepest in the United States at that time. And out in the desert, there were some amazing caves with amazing crystalline formations and helictites in them. Dale Green became my sidekick, and we explored everywhere within a 5-hour drive from Salt Lake City. I was almost finished with my surgical training in Salt Lake when the Navy decided they wanted to recall me to active duty. I'd been in the reserves to be the ship medical officer on a small carrier. And that took me out into the Far East, and most especially Okinawa. And in Okinawa, I found a totally different type of stream that was shaped more like lava tube caves than anything I'd seen anywhere else. In 1957, I finished my training, went back to Seattle to set up my practice, made the big tour of the United States that I was speaking of. The years passed, and eventually I started going to Hawaii to specifically study the lava tube caves, especially in the caldera of Kilauea volcano. And I was able to get a Hawaii grotto started. It too has had its problems because it was a speleological survey. It's done a fantastic job of mapping and studying a couple of thousand lava tube caves. They didn't need me after a while. I regret very much the condition I am in. I'm essentially blind from glaucoma. I can't, if I write something down, I can't read it. And as you can tell, I can't hear worth a damn. But it's been a fascinating life. Through the lava tube caves, I got active in international caving and got to some amazing places. I'm not going to try to enumerate any of them tonight because it might interfere with the program. Once you turn me on, it's hard to turn me off. But if I'm taking too long, turn me off. The NSS right now is facing a financial disaster. I think everybody ought to be made aware of it. The National Grotto might be in a position to help much more than most other grottos. I guess we've got about 200 grottos now, but Nashville is still a standout, especially because Gary Schindel in Texas, he was a graduate of the Nashville Grotto, and still thinks fondly of us. What happened was that a reorganization of the NSS in 1956 set it up so that it has a president and four vice presidents. But the president has no authority beyond that of the vice presidents. Essentially, we have five presidents, and officers' meetings several times a year are devoted largely towards squabbling, fighting over money for each officer's divisions. There are lots of excellent programs that have been developed by the NSS and funded through the NSS. But with the officers fighting for the money in the divisions, what has happened is that when two projects are about equally meritorious, they go ahead and fund both of them, whether there's money for it or not. And as you may have noticed, and us life members didn't notice, the dues have gone up to $50 a year now, which is much more than the young people can afford. Even graduate students can't afford $50 a year, and the membership has been dropping off every year by 100, 200. That cuts down the revenue that comes in from dues, so they have to raise the dues. That cuts down the membership even more, and it is a vicious spiral in which the NSS finds itself now. I have been on the NSS board for something like 52 of the 70 years I've been a member, and I've seen it firsthand. What is badly needed is an administrative reorganization of the NSS to give the president some power to exert fiscal discipline. In addition to the infighting in the officers' meeting, there is no attempt to make various projects stay within budget. The conservation and restoration manual is a particularly bad example of that. My understanding is that its final cost was something like five times the amount that the board authorized it to have. And instead of making the people who wrote it and supported it, rather than making them ante up the extra money, the board just went ahead and approved it to avoid controversy, even though we couldn't afford it. I think we very badly need a strong president of the NSS who can exert fiscal discipline. Otherwise, I have no idea how this spiral is going to occur. I hope the Grotto will take a real hard look at this problem. It's not going to be solved at the level of the NSS board. Power is never given up willingly. And I suggest that the Grotto study the problem and prepare a strong resolution to be presented at the Congress of Grottos at the Missoula Convention coming up this year, and prepare the way for it through Gary Schindel. I think this is extremely important, or pretty soon the NSS is going to be constituted entirely of us old buzzards who bought life memberships when they were cheap. And the lifeblood of the society is the young people, and they're being squeezed out of it. We've got to do something about it. If there's anything else you'd like me to say a few words on, come tell me about it. Otherwise, I'll shut up.
Has anyone got
Can I tell two short Bill Halliday stories? Bill, can you hear me?
Just barely. Speak into the microphone, please.
Okay. Yeah. Is it long enough?
No, you're going to have to move over.
Okay. He's coming to me.
Right here.
That close? All right. You got it?
Got it.
Well, in 1962, when I was 18 years old, I was involved in an accident up in Cookeville where Nick Crawford, some of you know Nick, fell in Thunderhole and suffered a compression fracture of his back and some other pretty serious injuries, and we had to haul him out and take him to the hospital. And when I got back to Cumberland Caverns, where I worked during the summer, Tank Gorin had me describe that accident into one of these old reel-to-reel tape recorders. I think it was a Sony, probably one of the first ones to come out. And Tank played that for Bill Halliday, and Bill put me in his book, Depths of the Earth, that came out in 1966. And when you're 18, being mentioned in a book is a big deal. So I always admired Dr. Halliday for being a great author.
Did that book have a picture of you with the gypsum lips in Cumberland?
Yes, I believe it is. It's a picture of me in Cumberland Caverns looking at the gypsum lips, and I never knew it was me. My mother was looking at the book one time and realized it was me. The other thing, real quick, of course, I got to know Bill after that and caved when I could. But when I got back from Vietnam, I got interested in black and white photography, and I took several pictures in the early 70s that Bill wanted to put in his new book, American Caves and Caving. And so when the book first came out in 1974, he called and said he was in town and wanted to give me a copy. And so we met at Ireland's right across the street from Vanderbilt Law School and had lunch. And he gave me the book. And I was so young and impetuous, I didn't open it to realize that he had signed it with extreme thanks. And it was his birthday. It was his 48th birthday. And he had put that in the front of this book. So I'm going to ask him to sign it again now that he's 91. I'm 41 years later, or 44, whatever it is. But Bill is a legend in the NSS. And we've been really fortunate here in Nashville to have him for all these years. And he's an honorary member of our Grotto. And in my book, one of the greatest cavers in America.
Okay, thanks, Ed. I give you a quarter of that.
He said it just like you wrote it, didn't he?
Yeah.
Bill, can you say something more about the very beginning of the NSS with Bill Stevenson and how even the Bill Stevenson thing came together? And also, is it true that Tank Gorin was hitchhiking during the war and Bill Stevenson picked him up with a car full of cavers and said, you want to go with us today? And that was the beginning of Tank Gorin in caving.
I hate to say this, something I don't know.
Tank never told me that story. I tend to doubt it.
Well,
Tank picked up caving when he was at the University of Virginia.
But he told me that on his porch up there.
He told you that?
Yeah. However, no one else ever heard.
Nobody else ever heard.
Yeah.
Well, you're a source close to the White House then.
Well, I wasn't around at the beginning of the NSS, so there's not much that I can say in addition to what I said before. It started out as a Sunday school outing club. It became the Speleological Society of the District of Columbia, and it developed very quickly dreams of being national, and I am honored to have been a part in spreading it throughout the West. Is that satisfactory?
Yep.
Does anyone else have anything?
Ask me about Bill Cuddington, because I know there's some pictures in American Caves and Cave of Bill Cuddington.
I can't understand a word.
He wants to know about Bill Cuddington.
This crazy kid, Bill Cuddington, started rappelling in caves without a safety rope. And the wise old buzzards on the NSS board, some of them were on the point of reading him out of the society because they saw it as unsafe. But I thought it had great potential, and I encouraged him in every way possible and wrote him up in the book too. It worked out pretty good, didn't it?
If you want to know more about Bill Cuddington, we have about a 90-minute interview that was done with Bill in a studio back in 2003 when we were preparing for our 50th anniversary. And I've got a copy of it. Jody's got it on his computer. And sometime it might be fun to edit that a little bit and bring it to a meeting, because he tells a lot of that history in that interview.
And David Hughes' book is interesting too.
Yeah, of course, there's a book about him, Vertical Bill, but hearing it in his own voice is, to me, a lot better than reading it in a book.
Well, anyhow, in about a week, I'm flying home to Seattle, and we'll be living with my daughter on the north side of the Olympic Peninsula in the thriving metropolis of Squim, which is spelled S-E-Q-U-I-M. But at the rate these problems are progressing, at the age of 91, I'll probably be going into an assisted living center close to where she lives pretty quickly.
Well, Bill, I just want to say it's been great getting to know you, a little bit that I got to know you towards the end of your life, and it goes for like Larry and Ed and Gerald here and a lot of these older guys are really, you're really inspiration to us younger folks, and you know, a big part of the pride of the Nashville Grotto is getting to know folks like yourself and you, Ed, and Larry, and Gerald, and I say I speak for the Grotto, but I'm really just speaking for myself, and it makes me proud to be a Nashville Grotto member, and I'll always respect and appreciate you.
Well, thanks very much. I hate to say goodbye, but it's time.
Yeah. Well, Dr. Holliday, you're willing to sign some books, because there's about 50 of them that needs to get signed.
How do you want to work that then?
Well, if you don't mind sticking around, are you guys sticking around for a little bit?
How long do you need?
Because we do have a presentation, so I don't know, should we do that first? Or?
Sure.
Don't decide.
Yeah.